Okay, विकास आप करो।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। आई ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ बियॉन्ड लॉ वेलकम यू ऑल टू अनदर एंडेवर on behalf of Beyond Law CLC, to the effect to bring on the platform the persons who are well equipped with knowledge and insights along with their experience. As we have always been saying that the purpose of Beyond Law CLC was that we could have sessions which are not only connected with law, but also beyond law. That is, we believe that as a professional, you will always have to have knowledge, leadership, communication skills, different aspects. And on this endeavor, on this platform, we had various honorable Supreme Court judges, High Court judges, former Chief Justice. We also had on this platform former IAS officer, Mr. Vivek Atre, and the former DGP of Chandigarh, Mr. Luthra. In this pursuit, we thought that when the question of leadership comes, one question we would always ask within our mind as to whether leadership is also required as a professional, or leadership we would always correlate with an ordinary person. In ordinary parlance, we say it's with politics, or leadership within the trade union politics. And as to whether there is some semblance of leadership with the scriptures, this issue invariably keeps on boggling the mind of a common man. And when the team was looking forward to a person who could give insights, we saw that not only on the Facebook, but his various articles, including on the Medium, were full of leadership. So as they say, the best way to look forward is a person who has the knowledge and immense insights over this. They say that the lamps can give the light in even the dark areas of any spheres. Amongst us, we have Mr. KBS Sidhu, who is 1984 batch IAS officer, and he's a special chief secretary to Government of Punjab. Those who have been following him on the Facebook and other articles will find that his insights are different and enriching to not only to one, but to all. And when we were just looking through his resume, we find that he stood second as an IAS officer when he was trying for an IAS. Then he's from Thapar. In fact, my brother-in-law wrote that he's an LMS from our college of Thapar. The immense knowledge, including his academics, speaks volume for that. But it's a time when we ask Mr. Sidhu to take over. But before we ask him, to the participants who invariably know that the session is around 40-45 minutes, we thought it should be more like an interactive session. We requested Mr. Sidhu to give insights of the topic what we are looking forward. And that's why it's one of the rare occasions where we have even posted on the Facebook and the social media, to the effect that those who want to post questions, which could be taken up by Mr. Sidhu. We had received many questions, and some questions which invariably we find would boggle the mind of any person. We would also be asking these questions from Mr. Sidhu, and Mr. Sidhu has been kind enough to accede to our request to give his insights beyond the topic itself, though the questions we will be taking only with respect to the leadership and the life and leadership lessons from the ancient scriptures. There are issues where Mr. Sidhu can give his insights, but keeping view the fact, as a lawyer, we say that one should always be focused, and as in the scripture, they said the Arjuna lesson was that one should be focused, and that is why you can only achieve success. Therefore, we would always ask the participants to post the questions, maybe on the Facebook, since we are live on the Facebook, that the questions should be related with the leadership. And thank you, sir, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and myself, It was, even though we are at Chandigarh, it is a rare thing that we couldn't meet across, but on the virtual platform, we have been able to connect with the people whom we otherwise admire or always feel that we should be able to connect. This is a good platform during these lockdown times and the unlocking period. We have been able to connect with people like you of and your station. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, friends. Thank you very much, Vikasji, and thank you, Beyond Law CLC. When I was first approached to address on this forum, and more particularly do so live, so I was a little hesitant because I am neither a student of law in the formal sense, and nor am I a student of the ancient scriptures in that sense. Though, of course, from a managerial perspective, one has been writing articles on the internet, medium.com, some otherwise published. But having said that, I think Vikasji was able to convince me, and I am there with you to talk to you and also, to the best of my ability, answer questions. Before I formally begin, I think the format which we have agreed would more or less be that within the constraints of the time, I would like to go and speak for about 20-25 minutes. And some very interesting questions, I'm told, have already come. And they would be unrolled and put by Vikasji. And then instead of my going through an extemporaneous decantation, so to say, and then repeating and referring to those questions, it'll be best if focused and precise replies to those questions are given. So that, I think, would bring about more clarity. So that's how we intend to proceed. I speak for about 20-25 minutes, and then there are interesting questions which I'll try and answer. But before I get into this issue formally, I think in many circles, following Government of India's advisory regarding Zoom, there have been very various questions as to, you know, whether official or demi-official institutions should be using Zoom. A number of precautions have been given as to what the host or the administrator should be doing. But I think the most simpler one for the participants to follow would be if they can create an email ID specifically for such purposes, so that your other data potentially, which could be compromised, would not be getting into the cyberspace. So those of you who are going to be frequenting the cyberspace through Zoom, it would be a good idea to create a specific and a special purpose email ID that you would use for joining these Zoom meetings. And also that if you're logging in from your mobile phones, if you can put your phone onto a DND, do not disturb mode, that will really focus your attention onto the speaker, onto the proceedings, because otherwise incoming calls and incoming messages and screen notifications, they tend to distract you. So with this little preamble, I would then, with your permission, sir, start my little talk. We are living in, I would say, interesting times. In fact, it is a famous Chinese curse, an ancient Chinese curse. If they want to curse you, they say, may you live in interesting times. So more by accident or by design, I don't know. We, in this day and age of COVID, are living in interesting times. And there are, within this set of interesting times, questions regarding life, leadership, how we conduct ourselves, our organizations, how we manage our lives. Those questions are A, bothering our people, and B, we are trying to seek answers. And in the true sense of the term, this situation is unprecedented, because never has there been an occasion where globally people have been affected in a similar way. Otherwise, you could have, you know, islands of prosperity or islands of peace where you could migrate and say things are okay in Canada and Switzerland. What if the whole world is at war? This is a neutral country. But for once, we are in a scenario where everything and everyone is affected and similarly affected. The other is, we don't really know, even as we speak, as to what would be the time frame in which we would be able to overcome. I'm an eternal optimist, and I'm sure, and also the emerging news regarding vaccines and so on, that we would eventually, as denizens, as citizens, as dwellers of planet Earth, be able to conquer this contagion. But till we do so, I think we have to fight unitedly, not only with the virus itself, but also with the demons that may come within us, and we have to slay those and tackle those. Now, in this scenario, one thing I personally believe is that eventually after we conquer, there are two things which are going to be different. The equilibrium of this planet and equilibrium in the life of every individual is going to be different. Even if the virus ends, we are not going to go into an equilibrium. We are going to question what were we doing for, what was the ultimate purpose of the pursuits that we are following. Those type of questions will come, and ultimately the equilibrium that you may reach would be different. You may not strive so much to make money. You may have more time for the family. You may or may not like to travel abroad. So those, where that equilibrium is going to come, is going to be fundamentally different. Equilibrium apart, I think the trajectory in which things are going to move is also going to be different. Now, whether that trajectory is in direction A, B, or C would be a matter of discussion and debate. But having said that, it will not be the business as usual type of a thing. People saying that, okay, within 6 months, the restaurant business, the airlines business, hotel business, the legal business is going to be the same. People are going to have a different equilibrium and going to go in a different direction. What is that? We really don't know. So leadership, especially during the time of crisis, suddenly becomes important. But leadership is important not only in times of crisis. Leadership is, I think, is built in and ingrained where any individual or a set of individuals, they are working collectively, either formally or informally. I have a small article which I had written on medium.com trying to distinguish between what a leader is and what a manager is. A manager is basically managing staff who are on the payroll of an organization, being given objectives, and those objectives he's trying to follow. Management is not a do-it-yourself or DIY affair. You're getting your team to do it. It's a smaller organization-based thing which a manager does. So of course, a manager needs to have the qualities of leadership, whether you're managing a small legal firm, or you're running a small retail business, or you're a CEO of a huge private organization, or a CMD of a public sector organization. Even you are, in that sense, a manager, you would also be exhibiting leadership qualities. But leadership is much wider. A dictionary meaning of leadership would go something like a person who leads or commands a group, organization, or a country. Now, here the lines which connect you are really dotted lines. It is not that you're the senior vice president in a company and so is reporting to you and you can command him, this is the budget available. A leader has followers, and those followers have faith and trust in him. A leader does not have, in the legal sense, business always something to direct the followers. And therefore, a leader is at a different platform altogether. Now, interestingly, in this age when we are all apprehensive, the spiritual gurus and the leaders are speaking in terms of how to apply leadership qualities and spiritual discipline into your everyday life, whether you're working in the corporate sector, government sector, legal sector. That's one. And on the other hand, management gurus like Robin Sharma and so on are emphasizing on how to disconnect, how to meditate, and how to achieve your corporate objectives using techniques which essentially would be from a spiritual perspective. But what leadership essentially is? I think the basic tenet of leadership is about decisions and actions, and thereafter taking the responsibility. You know, a lot of emphasis in the Holy Bhagavad Gita is given to action. And even otherwise, we say, you know, even Shakespeare said, action is eloquence. I mean, people may say so many things, but if you don't act, it remains in the sphere of dormance. So action, but what we forget is that action is not a random act, action for the sake of action. And yes, Prime Minister, they say, please do not confuse activity with productivity. So action has to be preceded, A, by a strategy, B, by decisions. And decision is nothing but taking alternatives which are available to you and taking responsibility for the consequences. Because each and every decision that you take ultimately will entail consequences, and a leader necessarily must take consequences for those. And at each point, it is not a deterministic yes, no mathematical precise formula. There are ethical dilemmas, and those ethical dilemmas may both be legally, constitutionally, organizationally correct. But one of them is something which you have to decide and take that decision. And those dilemmas will have entirely different, those decisions which you follow would have entirely different set of consequences, having impact not only on you and your immediate family, your team members, your organization, but if you are a person having influence, a political leader, leader of a country, of a state, of a huge multinational company, you would be having an impact on your citizens, on your stakeholders at large. So therefore, leadership is about taking those decisions. And if you see, those decisions have to be sometimes taken in a specific time frame. I mean, you don't have in real life the luxury of indefinite time. You can deliberate those, that time may be 5 minutes, it may be 5 hours, it may be overnight, it may be a week, in which you have to consider the pros and cons, consult, do everything. But at the end of the day, the decision has to be taken, and the window of opportunity in which the decision has to be taken is limited. So therefore, within that limited window of opportunity, analyze or ingest whatever information. But definitely one thing which is a recipe for disaster is that if you overanalyze the situation, as often the management books tell you, that you can have a paralysis by overanalysis. You can keep on doing that analysis and ultimately still not reach a decision which is proper and appropriate. So it is about time and timing. I mean, there has to be something within you which is telling you that here is the time has come for me to take this decision. I mean, Shakespeare beautifully put it, I think it was from Hamlet. He said, there is a tide in the affairs of men, which taken at flood leads unto fortune. So there is a tide. If you take it at flood, it leads you to fortune. And conversely, if you don't, omitted, the entire journey of life is confined to shallows and miseries. So therefore, when the tide comes, when the opportunity comes, it is the leader who has to take the decision, and his followers, the people of his team who trust him, they will follow. And ultimately, whether it was Moses or whether it was Mosi Tung taking the 1,000-mile march, or wherever you started, whether it was Lord Ram going into exile in compliance with the wishes of his father, all these things unfold when you take decisions within that limited time frame, and then things follow. Now, from here, as I emphasize that, and since I'm talking essentially to a legally oriented audience, decisions and evolution of decisions is not necessarily a legal or a constitutional issue. I think within the last year, the law did not change, the constitution did not change, but the overall ruling of the apex court as regards adultery, as regards homosexuality, we have now a different paradigm altogether. So within changing times, the leadership, even if the law per se did not change, different decisions come. And that is also a kind of an exhibition of leadership in the sense that we are talking about. Now, what I intend to take you through quickly is what are the attributes of leadership. Now, some of the books, they say there is nothing like leadership. It is simply exercising leadership. You seize the opportunity It is not about labels and titles. And if you seize the opportunity and you exercise leadership, if there is a house on fire, you have a chowkidar sitting out there, and he says, my job was only to guard this godown. So what if it is on fire? On the other hand, he can say there is a family sleeping there. He informs the fire brigade, but rushes into the building and, you know, saves those people. So that is the exercise of leadership. So the few attributes that I'll run you through is that A, exercise of leadership is essentially risky. You are trying to expand your role as an individual within the organization, within the team. You are trying to stretch the envelope, but you ought to know to what extent you want to stretch the envelope. It's just like blowing a balloon. Beyond a certain limit, it can go putt. So you stretch your role beyond the confines of your duty, of course, remaining within the legal confines and the constitutional constraints, but try to expand your role and be sure that this is going to be risky. But why do you take a risk? Is it for personal reward? No, it is because there are certain values that you deem very dear. It could be value for freedom of speech. It could be value for certain other aspects which you think that should be permitted within this country or within this organization. And that's why you take upon yourself or take the cudgels to, you know, push the envelope. And as I said before, the other point is, it is about initiative. No one is going to tell you that A, B, C are the qualities. These are your duty chart and you stick to that. In fact, in a governmental system, sometimes if you go beyond that duty chart, it can be looked as askance that you are, you know, going beyond your duties, but it is the initiative, and a leader has to have initiative. A person who's passive cannot really be a good leader. In the Mahabharata, we've got a very important lesson coming in, the balance between passion and patience. Now, that is really what a good leader needs. Every day, any common individual needs to derive these lessons from Mahabharata, for instance. So the Kauravas, they are in a 12-year exile. Now, you've got to be patient. And within that patience, they go through those 12 years, including the Gyatvas and so on. They could not go berserk. They could not go mentally imbalanced, saying that, okay, now we are here, what to do? And, you know, try to break their woes or build up an army and so on. But when it comes to the battleground, then the same patience is replaced by passion. The passion with which the Pandavas fought an army which was, on the paper at least, far more superior, and they won. So therefore, a balance between passion and patience and perseverance. It has to be peppered by perseverance. The balance has to be there. And that balance is very important. And that is something which cannot be taught. It has to arise from your inner GPS, as I've been using the word. But any number of examples in our holy scriptures where there are times when Lord Rama appears to be doing nothing, but he's actually consolidating a force of the Vanar Sena. And at the same time, when the battle actually comes, it is no hold barred battle because you are given a particular mission and you want to accomplish that. Indirectly also touch that there's a lot of intuitive aspect in leadership. Indirectly, when I talked about the paralysis by over-analysis, you may have data, you may have pilot studies, you may have everything. But when it comes to the crunch, ultimately there will be two decisions. And I think an intuitive element is always there. And intuition is nothing but your inner conscious telling you to take a particular decision, even if the raw data, even if the computer analysis, even if the Excel sheets which have been churned out may be pointing in a different direction. So that is really a dimension of a leader which distinguishes him from a manager. Leadership requires sacrifice. Sacrifice does not necessarily mean sacrificing your life in a battlefield. You may be required to do that. If you're a soldier, you are a general, and your country is at war. Sacrifice, it needs to be very clear that any person who wants to exercise leadership, it is at the cost of his personal time, space, comfort. Because you're a leader, because you hold a cause far more dearer than your daily job. It's not just about your vocation, it is about your calling. What are you here in this planet for? And when you do that, you have to sacrifice your family time. It is not about fancy cars and huge rallies. Even the spiritual gurus, the political personalities who have millions and millions of followers, they live a life virtually of a recluse because they are devoting their entire time and mental space to the pursuit of the values they dearly hold. A leader has to be fearless. In fact, leadership, agar Hindi mein kahe nidar, he has to be fearless, not to distinguish. You cannot say that there is nothing like danger. A leader must distinguish between what is fear and what is danger. Fear is something inside your mind. A child is afraid of going into the dark because he thinks there may be a ghost there. Danger, on the other hand, is something very real. You will put your hands into the fire, you will burn. If you try to cross a motorway where speedy traffic is around, you're going to be run over. So a leader does assess the dangers, but is still fearless. He tackles those. The risk may never be mitigated to zero, but he will be still fearless. And like the 10th Sikh Guru said, which is almost like a Sikh anthem, Deh Shiva Bar Mohe, he invokes Lord Shiva. And as a manifestation, the omniscient God, Shubh Kar Man Te Kabu Huna Taro. The word is taro in this verse, not daro, which comes subsequently. And what is taro? Let me not hesitate for then a moment. Let me not be flinching. Let me be unflinching. For what? Shubh Kar Man. Whatever values you want to imbibe and you want to pursue as a leader, then when the time comes, there should be no hesitation whatsoever. That is the leadership quality. And the third line, na daro aur so jab jaye lado. No, it's a battle-like situation. But when you actually then get into the battlefield, then it is na daro. So in normal course, na daro, not flinching from doing the good deeds. And when it comes to the wartime, na daro, then it is, you know, leap of faith and fighting to the hilt. Another thing which a leader kind of distinguishes is between faith and trust. His followers have tremendous amount of faith and trust in him. It is not about a contract that they've signed. It is not about some indemnities which the leader has given. In fact, most of the leaders who have been able to garner followers are the ones who've promised nothing but toil, sweat, and tears. And nevertheless, people follow those leaders. And it is not as if at the end of that, there is always a pecuniary reward for the followers. I mean, if you see the American Civil War, if the North was fighting the Confederates, those people were fighting for the slaves. It was not their battle. But time had come. And mind you, it was not too distant a history. It was the middle of 19th century, 18 something. And those people were fighting because the leadership had convinced them that this is a value which is very dear to you. So that is where a leader inculcates faith and trust, and he's able to impassion and embolden his followers for a cause which is far more than the personal pecuniary benefits that may arise. Then communication is the key. A leader has to be in communication with his followers. Miscommunication, lack of communication, that is something which leadership does not recognize. In this day and age, and I'm sure the series that Beyond Law CLC is organizing is an excellent example of leadership, because you are communicating with a large community, a legal community, and that communication is disseminating knowledge, which every person may not be an expert in that field. And mind you, communication is not a one way. It is not top down. that the person sitting at top is pontificating, is professorial, so to say. Here is a leader who's also having a feedback from the most modest of quarters and applying his mind, not just a kind of a consultation paper sometime in governmental system we publish and five suggestions come, you say, oh no, okay, it's fine, the same thing you already taken care of and the same policy is notified. So it is very clear that the communication has to be from top to bottom and also bottom to top, and the leader must be able to ingest and use that feedback and if necessary take the corrective action. Then leaders are not necessarily people with titles. Look at Mahatma Gandhi. I mean, I don't think he formally ever held a post in the National Congress, so to say. So therefore, these are the type of leaders who are beyond this type of formal titles, and yet people in the millions follow them and follow their mission because they see them as selfless, see them as people who would take them, have tremendous faith and trust. And then there is a question which often is asked, are leaders born, are leaders made? Now Shakespeare in a different context said, you know, some people are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. Similarly, I think leadership can also happen in all of these three ways. They may be born leaders. At the same time, there could be a crisis situation where you are the person on the spot and you have to take a decision and you have to ultimately do something to tackle a situation. So almost leadership which was thrust upon you. So it is in this context that we have talked about from a broadly managerial angle. So a couple of points which I'll make, and then we can perhaps get into questions. Firstly, in our scriptures, especially in the Holy Bhagavad Gita, and mind you, the entire Mahabharata is about 1 lakh verses, that is two lakh lines written by Rishi Ved Vyas. And those lines, within those, just 700 verses are the Bhagavad Gita. So the entire essence, the gist, almost distilled wisdom of universe is there. And what we often hear is to do your dharma. Now, dharma is not in religion in the accepted sense of the word. It is doing your sacred duty. And your sacred duty is not about your profession. It is not about your calling. It is a higher calling. What are you in this planet for? Are you even asking that question? I think if you ask that question, 50% you're already there. All right, I'm a lawyer. I have a nice practice. I'm going to expand, set up offices in Delhi. But what is it that I am doing? What is that I am doing for purpose of the poor clients? And I think some of your rewards would be when a man comes back, you know, the other party was influential, they had a top lawyer, they were willing to pay the top in the profession. But sir, you took this as pro bono, you took this for a modest fee, and I was ultimately able to win that case. I think that is the best reward that comes to you. Now, dharma, again, do your duty, is not a mute obedience of the system in which you work. This is often a pitfall which sometimes we all fall in. For instance, if you have something like a Nazi type of situation, now a Nazi general could say that, well, my duty was to obey what my generals were telling. And my general was telling, the supreme leader was telling that you have to eliminate Jews and do so without, you know, firing a single bullet. So therefore, I used gas chambers. Now, that is not his dharma. So when you are talking about dharma, it has to be a discerning dharma. It is not a kolu ka bal who is to go around without bothering as to where he's going to get. What was the dharma of a slave? As I said, till the middle of 19th century, slavery was legal in America, in Europe, in UK. Was it the dharma of the slave to be always obedient at a less than subsistent wage to his master. And there were penal consequences if he disobeyed. But Bhagavad Gita, which came far before the Christ era, 300 to 400 years before Christ, they said you have to be discerning. And that is where, by a discerning dharma, you are able to distinguish between the two. The other thing is that we often, right from class two classes, they say, okay, phal ki ichha mat karo, apna karam karo, phal ki ichha mat karo. And sometimes people say, you know, what is all this? We are working for reward, we put in hard work, and I'm entitled to my phal. Why am I working for? Why am I having this legal practice? Why am I running this business? Why am I building this tech company? If I'm not going to be bothered, my investors are saying, what is the dividend that you're going to give? Now, phal ki ichha, now this is my personal opinion, and this has been validated by some scholars when I did a research on the internet. Phal is a dividend which is personal in nature. You're working in a business, you're going to make income, that is something which is coming to you. So you are not to be distracted by that, because once you're distracted, then the focus that we talked about, then instead of your mission, you would be looking your back saying, hey, I'm making an extra buck in this or not. That is the distraction. But as I said, action has to be preceded by decision. And the decision has to be a discerning decision. Phal ki ichha also indirectly does not mean that the discerning decision that you take, which affects virtually thousands of citizens, of your stakeholders, multinational companies, the customers, and so on, that you should be absolutely oblivious of the consequences or the potential consequences that may visit upon them. So phal ki ichha is only in the nature of your personal dividend, personal rewards, personal to you. But phal ki ichha ki parwah mat karo does not mean that you are to disregard the impact on your followers or on your mission. So one point lastly, which I'll talk about, and then perhaps I'm told there are quite a few questions, we can take them. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, you know, ultimately we all die. Now, the interpretation of ultimately we all die does not mean marna to hai, you know, why should you know slag, slog, why do hard work? In any case, we all have to die. Now, there are two very important hidden messages which Lord Krishna has given. When he says we all have to die, he tells you very clearly that your time on this planet is limited. So therefore, if you want to do your good karma or dharma or log in your positive karmic points, then do not delay. Shubh karmanate na taro. So therefore, please go ahead and do your good karma, because in any case, the time at your disposal is limited. And on the other hand, it is also a message that you should not be over-attached with your things. This is my house. This is my practice. We come alone. We interact with people. We have internet. We come alone and we interact. We've got parents, spouse, children, so on. But at the end of the day, we go alone. All have to die is also a message which tells you that, okay, as a Karma Yogi, you please don't renounce your responsibilities as a householder. But no one is telling you to develop an over-attachment. That is the message from we all have to die. And similarly, that Atma is immortal. Now, it doesn't mean that if Atma is immortal, I can go around killing people and say, hey, okay, Atma is immortal and, you know, how can you charge me with murder? Atma is eternal means you are basically carrying your karmic points with you. You have positive karmic points, negative karmic points, and actually one belief is that those who have fewer negative points go to hell first. Nark mein wo, they'll go first and are able to purge them, a kind of a penance for the sins they may have committed. And then you have an extended stay in swarg or heavens. And there you're not there in perpetuity. It is almost like a prepaid credit card or a debit card, and once you are exhausted, you are back to where you began and the cycle of birth and rebirth. So therefore, there are a number of lessons which arise from here, and there are a number of answers which the script gives. But at the end of the day, you are going to be there alone. We don't have the luxury of Lord Krishna in life giving a sermon with question and answers, which Arjun had on the eve of the battle, great battle of Mahabharata. And therefore, we have to cull those out from whatever is available to us and take decisions and go forward. So I'll end here, sir. And we could take the questions if you can read those one by one. I would request that if a question has to come, sometimes there are three questions and one could be, you know, slightly confused. So questions may come one at a time and I'll try to answer them to the best of my ability.
Yes. So I will split it, but I think somebody has, there's a mic on of your side, because sometimes the voice is echoing it. Just ask someone who is hearing you from your office.
Do you think it is better now?
Yes, sir, it's better. So we will start taking the questions which we have received, and certain questions I would be very candid about that.
Yep.
Since the topic as such was quite different, so we had proceed questions on our end so that what we felt that
I was given a flavor of the question that were expected, and that is why, rather than trudging into that area, I have left those for the questions. I am happy to answer and address those.
Yes, sir. Questions. So first, we will just take the simpliciter question, then we'll correlate with the scriptures part. How does a leader know when to act, when to wait, and be patient? What are the attributes to that? What do you feel that?
That is the whole essence of leadership. A person has to have self-control. You know, sometimes you are raring to go. Here, there's a situation developing on China, let's go and attack them. It's all very, very simple to talking that term. But you have to think things through. And there has to be patience. It's all about time and timing. And patience cannot be indefinite. I mean, you could spend a lifetime, you know, being patient and get nowhere. So it is therefore this intuitive aspect which I talked about. And knowing your inner GPS, weighing the risks, pros and cons, but not getting into a paralysis of overanalysis. And then when the tide comes, be sure that you take it. So it's more of an art than a science. It is less of a number churning and data processing. It is really, but action is there. And remember, in life, you will at the end of it regret more things on which, more opportunities that you don't take, rather than the opportunities which you took and you may have failed. So when in doubt, I would suggest action rather than inaction.
I can correlate with that what we commonly say is that it's better to try and fail rather than failing to try.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So this question is from the Facebook itself. The person had posted it to me. This is by Mr. Nitish Kumar. He says, do you think ancient Indian scriptures and various texts can lead us to a better society and system of governance if followed properly?
I think so. In fact, the word governance that we've used is a recent invention. I mean, we used to have rule, and then we had administering, and then we were talking in management, and now we're talking in terms of governance. And as you say, governance is a neutral term. A governance could be applied to a constitutional monarchy, to a democracy, to a military dictatorship, to an absolute monarchy like Saudi Arabia. So governance really does not imply the form of government that you're talking about. At the end of the day, it is about the citizens or the subjects, depending on the system of government. And we can, of course, take the lessons from those scriptures that we have. And those lessons we can apply in the modern day context. Those are universal principles. Why they are universal principles? Because the human emotions are universal, of love, of greed, of fear. Those have not changed. Putra Moha, agar at that time was there, it is there today also. If you have reverence for your father to comply with his wishes, it is here today also. If you want to do something for your country, that sense of nationalism is here as well, irrespective of the... So therefore, we can definitely take the guiding principles and try to fit them into whatever constitutional legal framework that we have. and I personally feel that those beacon lights can guide us through. But they are broad beacon lights. It is like the Northern Star. It is like a lighthouse. But the micro navigation is ultimately the political leadership and every citizen who's empowered to be taking enlightened and informed decisions.
Since we had a talk on scriptures, next question would be, our scriptures were written hundreds of years before the Christian era. That is before the Christ. How can then we draw lessons from them which are relevant, and can they be said to be relevant in this age and era?
Very interesting question, but actually I have really answered it previously. I mean, those human emotions, the conflicts, the dilemmas which we face today, two situations. It could be as simple as a situation. You are a leading lawyer. Your child wants to be a good doctor. And you want him to say, you're my only child and please do, why don't you study law, this huge practice you have to inherit. Now, those dilemmas, both for the father and the child, are there. So therefore, since the issues at work are essentially the same, fear, greed, conflict, what responsibility, what is the hierarchy of your duties? What is exactly your calling? So therefore, more than ever before, when the world is becoming complex and there is so much of noise, so to say, literally and figuratively speaking, it is the principles which come from our apex, the distilled wisdom, which is immutable over ages. If you apply it to your context, you'll be definitely able to have a tool, a facilitating methodology to answer your question. They are, in fact, in this day and age, especially in this COVID age, more relevant than ever before, because these are timeless, these are universal.
The next question we can take is, as they say that there are a number of commentaries of our ancient text by very erudite scholars, in particular Bhagavad Gita, most of them are available online. Aren't we there virtually in the same position as Arjun to ingest Gita ka gyan?
Very, very interesting question, I must say. You know, recently I was trying to analyze some verse and I found so many interpretations coming from very erudite scholars. And then I realized that Arjun was perhaps in a far better situation than us. How? A, none other than Lord Krishna himself was giving the discourse, the Gita ka gyan. So nothing, so to say, was lost in translation. Number two, Arjun was not a person who was not spiritually evolved. He was almost there. He was a karma yogi. He was asking the right, he had the right doubts, and those doubts had to be clarified. And it's like a PhD scholar trying to then address a person who's a primary school student. That discourse, that knowledge transmission would not take place. Arjun was at that level. So are we at that level? But more importantly, and most importantly, he had the luxury of asking questions in an interactive, real-life, face-to-face situation. We do, of course, have, you know, internet sites where you could post your question, query, doubt, and, you know, different scholars could give different answers. So yes, let us try. But I think in real life, in the day and age of Bhagavad Gita, Arjun was blessed to be receiving that Gita ka gyan directly from Lord Krishna himself, and having the luxury of asking questions in a real time.
So this is where Vipul Joshi, he has posted on the chat box. So how do you rate accountability versus taking responsibility from the point of view of a leader? In other words, in an organizational setup, how important is it for a leader to take personal responsibility of anything that may have gone wrong, as against the fastening of the accountability around the individual member who may have erred?
Okay, again, a very good question by Vipul Joshi. I understand he's a young and upcoming lawyer. Now, firstly, we kind of mix the three words, accountability, responsibility, and, you know, at the extreme is the culpability. So it is a continuum. What is the responsibility? There is a rail accident. The railway minister may like to take responsibility in the sense that you know, I'm going to resign because this accident has taken place. Although it was a gate man who happened to be sleeping when he should have been, you know, closing the gate. That is at the element of responsibility. Yes, he cannot but be responsible for whatever good or bad that happened. Accountability is in the sense that you took a decision and there are positive and negative consequences. Of course, you have to remember that hindsight, everyone is having a hindsight of 2020. At that particular point in time, you took a decision. You have to be held accountable in a managerial sense and also in a karmic sense. And of course, third point is at the pole of culpability. If you've done something which is in the nature of a criminal offense, the law should and must take care of itself. But to conclude, Vipul, what I feel is that in our governmental system, petty leaders or glorified managers, they would like to hog the credit themselves rather than passing it down the line. And whenever things go wrong, they would then apportion the blame. I think the major difference between a manager and a great leader is that he distributes the credit. Meri team ne kiya, I was there just in the background doing this. And on the other hand, if things go wrong, he says, yes, I made a mistake. These are the consequences. Do you want to have another leader? Or here is my plan B to take care of the consequences. And I'm not going to start a witch hunt and say, so-and-so was the person who's letting me down. So that's the difference in, you know, taking responsibility, apportioning blame, and, you know, distributing credit.
I'm reminded one of the what we receive in the WhatsApp good morning messages. It said that when you said that if the plan A fails, you can try that. He said that when the plan A fails, you have more 25 alphabets, you can try the other 25 alphabets.
There are two views at it. You know, some people say that you cannot have a plan B. If you have a plan B, if you have not burnt your bridge, so to say, then you would not be going full thrust with your plan A. So please take some time and formalize and finalize a plan A, which is close to perfect. And if things go wrong, then we'll think about the plan B. So there are two styles of leadership, but ultimately I think at the back of everything, you need to have a kind of a safety net. But if there is too much of a safety net, then I am sure that passion with which a leader and his followers would go, they should know this is now or never. It is between freedom and slavery in perpetuity. So you can't have a middle path. And sometimes plan B can actually dilute the passion with your team is working. But behind somewhere, you should be quick to, you know, then have a second plan B as well. The plans may change, but the goal should remain.
Yes, sir. So though you had answered somewhat, but still we had that question. If as per Gita, we are not to be distracted by fruit or labor, the afal ki ichha, then what is an incentive for an individual to put his best? Because I would just add further to this question. It is said that if you can't have the cake and eat it too, then what is the purpose of having that cake?
The question was answered, but basically you see, personal, I would be the, you know, last person to glorify failures, you know, failures being pillars to success and so on. So we have to try. Success is you set for yourself a milestone, you want to reach it. And mind you, in a younger generation, sometimes you are working for the milestone which someone else has set for us. You know, my father may have told, hey, you got to become a good IAS officer. Someone's granddad may have said, no, you got to be a good lawyer. So firstly, if you really are wanting to achieve success, are you having that success by what you want, or are you living to the standards of what others expect of you? A son of a lawyer could want to be an artist. So if he becomes a good lawyer at the end of it, he may still say, I actually wanted to be an artist, a painter. So would you call him successful or not? So it all depends what you wanted to achieve. Fruit of labor, as I told you, they will come. They may come to the desired or the expected level, they may not. But the idea of ke phal ki ichha mat karo is that it distracts you. For instance, if you are in stock market trading, each time you're looking into the screen, ki mere profit itna ho gaya, utna ho gaya, you know, then you would not be able to focus on where the market trend on a macro level is. So therefore, it is, when we talk in terms of focus, the phalki ichha is a distraction. And what Lord Krishna actually is telling you is that they will come, good, bad, ugly. You have no control over them. But please focus on the mission. And phalki ichha is a distraction. And of course, as I said, as a discerning individual, you cannot say, I'm on autopilot, I have done. What do I care what happens and what comes and doesn't come? You are a discerning individual. You have to constantly see what is the impact of your decision on your stakeholders, course correct, and see that the maximum benefit passes to the maximum number of people. So that is the import, in my opinion, of Phalki Ichha and a discerning individual.
This is by G. Balaji. How do you define leadership? Whether leadership is meant on the ability to lead the team or the ability to achieve the goal setting, as an example. Is he a torchbearer or taskmaster?
I think what I'll do is leave that link of a good manager and a good leader. So there are 21 points. It is actually a continuum. There is an overlap. But I think one thing is very clear. The mission of the leader must be clear. And mission is somehow much more broader than a managerial goal. A managerial goal could be an year-on-year increase of 15% on sales for the next 3 years. This is my quarterly targets. This is what I'm going to proceed. That is a more of a managerial type of a thing. Whereas a much wider would be a Steve Jobs type of a thing, that I am going to bring a product which is going to literally change the way universe is going to be thinking and working. So that is the level at which leadership, and there are no good, bad, ugly, we are not even talking about styles of leadership. There could be people who let go and empower their followers and the team member. There could be other people who are very, very, hands-on. There are 5-6 points. In fact, if you remember, there was a book in the 80s when they talked in terms of, 7 habits of highly effective people. That particular literature is available. They say, network, get your priorities right. And the 7th quality was sharpen the saw. Which is, if you are in legal profession, this is exactly what CLC is doing at the moment, trying to sharpen the saw, keep up the skills, because when you use the saw, it kind of gets blunt. But I'll run you through quickly in a minute, is what are the good qualities? Sometimes to learn how to do good things, you also need to know how not to. What things to avoid. They could be great people, but they do not delegate. And if you do not delegate, no leader, even if he's spending 24 hours a day doing anything, can be successful. Do what is important and urgent at your level, and rest has to be delegated. Pick up the right member and give them the responsibility and authority to do it. And if as a leader, you don't have confidence in the team, okay, I'm going to tell him, but he may not be able to do it. Then you cannot be a good leader. And one very, very frequent type of an attribute of the leader is revisiting the decision. You have a 5-hour meeting. You decide this is the strategy we're going to go and do it. Next morning you get and you're in doubt. And again, you're calling your team. Should we do like this? I was thinking. Now, not for a moment am I saying that if there is entirely a new data, entirely a new factor which has developed overnight, you should not revise and revisit the decision. But in absence of anything new which is coming, constantly revisiting decisions is going to create an air of uncertainty in your organization. And that is what needs to be avoided. And then, of course, we talked about focus. Sometimes there can be too much of it. No, that's the paradox. Okay, focus on the overall mission. But please also see what is happening around the world. You say, I want to create this drug. But what is happening around? What is happening to the competition? What has happened in a COVID scenario? Is it a preventive type of a thing? Or is it as therapeutic and so on and so forth? So focus has to be there. But like the aware individual, And that is what an aware individual, Lord Krishna, has talked about. While you're focused, very fine on your mission, on your task, but doesn't mean for everything else, you are totally in a vacuum. So therefore, that is also very important. And the last thing which the leader should not do is a kind of a victim syndrome. When things go wrong, you blame each and every, you know, my film was good, but the critics did this. You know, it happened on a Friday when other big movie was opening. And okay, you know, I am a great batsman, but the cricket pitch was such. You know, the umpire was against me. So that victim syndrome, to account for your failures, you cannot take it too far. You need to take that sense of responsibility. And then brooding over failure. Okay, everyone fails. Are you going to brood over it forever? Draw lessons, get back to the drawing board. And while the victor is still celebrating the gold medal that he's won in the Olympics, you got the bronze medal, you're heartbroken. So while he's celebrating, you're already preparing for the Olympics warriors down the line. So get over it and get ahead. So these are the type of things, attributes, desirable qualities and not so desirable qualities. But having said that, there is no perfect leadership style. Ultimately, he's whoever is able to enthuse his team members, his followers to achieve the objective. But that objective has to be a shared value which people hold very dearly. If there is a conflict, if there are undercurrents, then somewhere down the line, the leadership will crumble. The organization will split. That you have to clarify, you know, when you join that mission.
So Sanjay Shah asked, what are the 5 key attributes of a leader? Rather, I was just, while you were talking of 7 effective steps, I was just reminded that you had written one article in the Medium. You had written, what are the 7 ineffective steps which could have been avoided?
This is exactly what I...
It could be a juxtaposed between the two and how to maintain, what are the 5 key attributes according to you?
I think we've already taken that. I think the gentleman may have started slightly later. I mean, you have to take initiative. You've got to rely on your intuition. It requires sacrifice. You have to be fearless. You have to have faith and following of your followers, communication, both way, up and down, and also challenging the reigning paradigm. You know, if everyone is doing what everyone else is doing, you will not stand out. All the leaders in world of innovation, etc. I mean, it could be a person saying, okay, you know, it is the desktop and the laptops which are going to be the next thing. It was someone who was saying that mobile phones are going to replace even the television. They're going to replace your laptop computers. So a person who goes against the reigning paradigm, that is the leader who ultimately makes the maximum impact. Others are just going with the trend and going with the flow. And as they say, only dead fish go with the flow. The contrarian opinion in stock markets, those who are familiar with that. So all these qualities make a good leader. And every good leader would also tell you that there is an element of luck, but luck favors those who take the opportunity. I mean, there are anecdotes that people tell you that, you know, a person who had made his billions, he was approached by a young intern to say, sir, what's the secret of your success? He said, son, well, to grab the opportunity when it came. And he said, sir, that's precisely my question. I mean, how do you know that the opportunity has come? He said, son, you have to keep jumping. So therefore, you have to make constant effort, of course, not to fritter away your energy in a focused manner, and ultimately you will get success.
We will take questions which have come, but Yuvraj Sharma asked, how do you motivate the juniors in a leadership style, and especially you?
You know, first of all, what I tell them, and which I would tell any person, young, old, is that there is no one unique leadership style. Some people are very hands-on. Some people are delegating. Some people grow into broad details. Other people go down into the, you know, small print. But you have to discover your own innate leadership style and tell the people, hey, I am now empowering you. You know, our Indian system of management and companies, and I've seen from very close quarters in public sector undertaking, private sector undertaking, the man will say, hey, you are totally empowered to do this. But when you take a decision, they say, oh, why did you do this? If you want to delegate, you have to delegate responsibility and authority also. So my answer is that you have to discover your own innate style of leadership. It's just like style of singing. Everyone cannot sing like Muhammad Rafi. Mukesh could excel in his own way. So please don't try to ape anyone and say that he's my role model. And to me personally, for instance, it has happened. Kiji, bade naram hai, you don't tell anyone anything, you know. And if you try, yeah, I'm going to be more assertive and so on. All you start doing is to create a stress for yourself internally. In a different context, Nikola Tesla, of course, the great inventor of the last century, he said, if you want to study and unlock the secrets of universe, study what is frequency, what is vibration, what is energy. Of course, he was using in the sense of physics. But I think if you extrapolate and interpolate to how your own mind is working, this really is talking about where your natural frequency is. Are you vibing? Are you in resonance with what your internal system is built up for? And people will respect that, irrespective of your style of leadership. So follow your innate. There's no particular optimal leadership style.
So this is correlated with the scripture part. It says, what is the most important lesson that we draw regarding the quality of leaderships from the epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata, given the basic strengths / capacity of the team?
I think if I were to just give one answer, it would be that a great leader can transform an ordinary team comprising ordinary members into a winning combination. And on the other side, you may have great, you know, people in your ranks, but if the leadership is faulty, the leadership fails, then even such a great team can meet disaster. So this is really, if you compare the Vanarsena of Lord Ram and the great army which Ravan had arrayed, and similarly on the battleground of Kurukshetra, you see, of course, they were guided by none other than Lord Krishna himself, the Pandavas. But at the end of the day, it's the leadership that makes all the difference. I mean, there have been on American stock markets, you know, people who were Nobel laureates in economics and building economic models and putting in churning numbers and computers and predicting, and those companies went bust because the leadership was lacking. So therefore, I think the essence from both our epics and from anywhere in the history, if you see, it is all about the leadership, and leadership really transforms, energizes, synergizes an ordinary type of a team into a winning combination.
So the point according to you is that in Mahabharata, there were 5 Pandavas and 100 Kauravas, but yet they were able to succeed. So key taken according to you is that if there is right management and right leadership quality, then these numbers don't count. It is the main strength and strategy does count.
And also the internal strength of leadership would come that, were you fighting for a just cause? So the source of strength of the leadership is, yes, you know, you usurped a part of my kingdom. I'm asking what is mine. I'm not coveting your kingdom. So that internally, that cause, the calling, that has to be strong, and plus a strong leadership, then of course, you know, you win.
This is by Rosie Ollock. What you said, it is correlated with that. How to follow a leader who works only to appease the superiors at the cost of the growth of the organization and its member? What is the way out?
If you are in a system of organization, then I think what you need to do is you're bound by the discipline. I have a small talk on Facebook regarding the ethical rebel in the leadership context. I would request ma'am to go through that. But having said that, there are going to be situations like this where on top of you sitting a person who is literally trying to hog the credit of his subordinates, and not only take the credit himself, also trying to project that, you know, my team is no good. This is a very common occurrence in public sector type of organizations, even in private sector, more so in private sector. So ultimately, you have to do your own PR. You have to project your work. Punjabi ji kehna kam karo vi mat kaho vi. So you have to do that. And in this day and age of social media, informal emails, you know, seeking time and telling the superior bosses, and ultimately your own capacity, your own innate ability will be taken note by your superiors. But of course, if you find a lateral path to get out of the way, if a person is going to stagnate you professionally in a career or spoil your career, then I think an important decision has to be taken that, am I going to exit? But that is the ultimate type of a decision. We try to manage it. We cannot rebel. You cannot say, I'm not going to follow your directions. You can resubmit the files so that at least the posterity knows that you gave an alternative viewpoint, which with the benefit of hindsight, people would say, aise hota to we could have done it. So that is how we can tackle. Yes, sir.
Sir, this is a question which we had received from the post when we had posted on the thing. This is by Nitish Kumar, and it's a quite interesting question. In Plato, Aristotle writings, we have read that the person on the highest post had to sacrifice a lot, and there were many restrictions on their lives too. Do you think that such kind of strictness is necessary for leaders in today's times? And when we frequently hear about the improper usage of power by a person?
I think partly that question has been answered in the sense that leadership requires sacrifice. And we as a Falki HR, no personal dividends that you're looking for. It's for a dear cause that you're trying to fight. Now, if a person is in a leadership position who is in for personal reward, and in personal reward by adopting means of which are not only illegal but also unethical, I think sooner or later he or she would be exposed. So therefore, most of the code of conduct would be self-imposed. It is not something which can be done externally. Of course, the law, the constitution constraints are there, and the same post, different people conduct themselves differently. That is a fact of life, and that is why we are talking in terms of the qualities of leadership. But having said that, ultimately, a person who's using power for pelf is bound to fall sooner than later. The essence of the whole thing is, it is the purpose behind the power and not the power per se that matters. Ultimately, history will remember people who utilize that power, whether it was a political, democratic, money, military dictatorship, you know, for the maximum benefit of the people, or whether they did it for their own personal benefit. So it is the purpose and not the power per se that matters.
This is by Vidit. He says, role of education and leadership in contemporary world. Because we are seeing for a long time, the educated person sometimes miserably fail in wooing the people through their intellect and sophistication and policies. While some persons attract the persons who speak eloquently, sometimes the result is not there.
Very interesting hypothesis. Firstly, let us try to distinguish between a couple of things. A person can be literate and a person can be educated. Two are entirely different things. And a person can be wise. He may neither be literate nor be educated. So I think as far as leadership is concerned, being educated is desirable, but it is neither the necessary nor the sufficient condition for leadership. For instance, if you take the great Emperor Akbar, he was born when his father Humayun was in exile in the deserts of Sindh. And at the age of virtually 16, when he was coronated as quote-unquote Mughal emperor, when Humayun passed away in Kalanaur, incidentally, in Gurdaspur district, he was the lad of 16. He had hardly gone to school. So therefore, and on the other hand, you have people like Jahangir who actually composed verses and so on and so forth. So therefore, being educated does help. But it is not as if uneducated people have not been great leaders. You could have PhDs who do not have leadership qualities. I rattled out those seven contra qualities to when we talked in terms of the habits of effective people. You could be a poor leader. So therefore, education is important, and education must be given preference. It allows you to analyze in multiple dimensions. Education has to be interdisciplinary, intradisciplinary, and multidisciplinary, because policy making and the problems of this world are not one which can be cut into and placed into a profession, a micro profession. But having said that, ultimately, I think the power to communicate, and whether it was the propaganda minister of Hitler or anyone else, the spoken word ultimately is more effective. And spoken word, A, not only because people are perhaps not literate, may not apply to this day and age, but the spoken word leaves an impact. And a leadership must, as I said, communication was one of the points. So that does make it. Being educated helps, but you need to then communicate, and communicate what? What the person are looking for. I mean, as a marketing thing, if I'm marketing something, if the person is not interested, that is where the skill lies. It's not about lies. It is about telling the people and interpreting to the large constituency that this is what I'm in here for. As they say, you can fool some people for all the time and all people for some time, but you can't fool all the people for all time. And that's how in democracies, people come and go. And that is how ultimately voters decide. And those who may have in 60s seen the debate between Kennedy and Nixon, the first time it was televised, Nixon was perhaps answering all the questions in a very technical format, whereas the other gentleman was talking in terms of ideology and making America great again. So it's how you enthuse, how you get that message across. It is not by solving a differential equation that you get the message across. It is by convincing the people. And that is where it happens, leader being educated, but being able to communicate. That's the ideal combination. But being educated is definitely not a necessary condition, even in this day and age, to be a great leader.
So this is again from the scripture part. It says, in Ramayana, Kumbhakarna advised and counseled his elder brother Ravana, but ultimately fought and died fighting for him in the battlefield. Whereas on the other hand, Vibhishan betrayed Ravana and ultimately got the kingdom. Who performed the dharma righteously, and what is your take?
This is exactly what the ethical dilemma is all about. What do you feel about it? And my answer is that both did their dharmas. Kumbhakaran, he liked his sleep a lot, but when he got up and knew the war clouds were around, he admonished his brother. He counseled him. He said, you've done the wrong thing by abducting Sita Mata. But his value system was, okay, I am going to stand by him. And he died fighting, and fighting gallantly. On the other hand, Vibhishan, he was a more milder character. He had again been telling, and he said, my inner GPS is not going to allow. So therefore, he quietly slipped there. So you could have and argue that this was right or that was right, but ultimately, I think both of them, the beauty is, did their own dharma. If you recall, even in Mahabharata, after the end of it all, when the Pandavas, they ascend the mighty Himalayas, only Yudhishthir is able to reach the doorway of heaven, accompanied by his stray dog, which was actually his dharma. And there he found that the Kauravas were enjoying in heavens and so on, and his brothers were perhaps confined to hell. There, of course, the Lord explained to him that, well, those people also had good karmas. They are enjoying the fruit of that good karma temporarily there. Your brothers have ABC sins, so let them atone for that for a limited time, and then they will, of course, go elsewhere. So it is your own internal ethics. After all, when two countries fight, each of the soldier is doing his own dharma. You may get a Nishane Haider on Pakistan side, or you may get a Paramveer Chakra on this side, but both in the army philosophy is, and army values are, that both have to be honored. So therefore, if you are doing your dharma by your inner GPS, I think that is what is important, and that was duly recognized. Even when Kumbhakarna died, he was given a decent funeral by none other than Lord Rama himself. He said, he's a great warrior. Please, he has to be given the funeral that he deserves. And as regards Vibhishan, he was not made a subordinate of Rama. He said, you are the true, the legacy of Sri Lanka has to be, Lanka has to be carried on. He was made more of an ally and, you know, left to rule Sri Lanka as a sovereign ruler.
Thank you. So, this is by G. Balaji. I have a view that cause is larger than the leader, and the leader needs to surrender to the cause for a common objective. Mahatma Gandhi is an example. Can you confirm whether this view is perfect in all scenarios, or there is a different take for it?
You know, of course, I totally agree that the cause, if it is unanimous, then the leader is subordinate to that cause. What happens is, when two things happen, A, either that cause is interpreted differently by half of the people, or when the leader himself, for whatever reasons, either, you know, ulterior motives or by way of incompetence or change of views, is trying to tweak the original cause. So that will create the internal stresses. But to answer the question, yes, the cause is bigger than the leader, but the cause should remain the cause that it was. If the cause is being, you know, hijacked in a particular direction, and the leader feels, no, this is not the path, this is not my original path, then the leader says, this is the cause, not the cause which you're not trying to impose or distort. So overall, if the cause remains the same, then the cause is bigger than the leader. But a leader who is facing a situation where the cause is being hijacked must assert his authority and bring back it to the proper orientation or direction.
So this is by Himanshu Kanda. He's a young student of law itself. It's slightly overlapping with the answer in the question which you had asked in the entire session. It says, in our life, when a person is on the way of becoming a leader or is a leader, how a person should get out of the mental pressure created by others, that is nepotism-like situation. How to handle it, because in law, or for that matter, in any career, this issue of nepotism and leadership does count.
You know, in life, early on, you have to distinguish between the constraints and the variables. Of course, some of the constraints are constraints because you have not grappled with them. And you should try to optimize your energy in the variable field first. And irrespective, and it's fashionable these days to talk in terms of nepotism, and especially in the context of Bollywood, a businessman's son inherits his business, a politician's son inherits the political legacy, a lawyer's son would inherit the practice, just as a chartered accountant's or a doctor's son would inherit his practice. Those are the advantages. But you also have seen where the people who inherited the natural advantages have frittered away. So what a newcomer has to do is he has to slog that extra bit. If you're going to work 12 hours a day, then sir, you have to put in 14 hours a day. And you have to bring to the table a value which perhaps the other person who's more complacent is not able to do. So those advantages are there. So just like in golf, you have a handicap system. So you have to work extra hard. And ultimately, in this day and age, where transparency is there and where your performance is known ultimately by the clients and the people, you can overcome this handicap. I am not for a moment saying that it is a level playing field. The natural advantages are there. Forget about anything. You know, better education could have been given by a person who's more well off. He starts off with a natural advantage. I could have gone to an English medium school, which the other person may not. But it is not as if those people are not able to overcome those. You have to work that extra bit. and you'll be able to do it. The history is replete with total outsiders who've come and really been like iconoclasts and have destroyed the prevailing order because it was old and corrupt. And they've been the rising new stars. Be that.
Sanjeev Chadha, he's in 42 years working in Mexico only. He says, I would like to understand which kind of leadership is better, authoritarian or empathetic. Whether the leader should lead by an example or let the followers take their own course. What is your take on that?
So I think we already answered that question in the sense there is no ideal leadership. So you have to, and also it is not a question that a leader has to have the same, like a grandsire cut in alabaster, as Shakespeare said. The leader has also to adopt, you know, different roots in different situations. Having said that, empathy is something very important. And empathy, we have to distinguish from sympathy. People are not looking for sympathy. Aap aaye, bahut bura hua and you go. Empathy is able to feel just putting yourself into their shoes. And you cannot classify a style of leadership as a static. As they say, you know, some laton ke bhoot baaton se nahi maante. In that situation, you have to be firm. I mean, you have to have an authoritarian style of leadership for that particular instance. But ultimately, to say A style is the best or B style is the best, I answered it earlier, it has to be in sync with your natural frequency. Because otherwise, over an extended period of time, it will only create stress for you and nothing else. And you will also not be a successful leader if you go against your own internal grain.
This is a question again from the scriptures part. There are few instances in the epic, for example, Bali and Sugriva fight and Yudhishthira saying the Ashwatthama is dead. If we feel that the top leader did not act morally ethical manner, how do you reconcile with that? For the convenience of the participants, you could just explain the Ashwatthama dead because large number of people in the today arena sometimes feel Ashwatthama, they have not heard, but they know that Ashwagandha is definitely there.
Ashwatthama was the son of the great general and wazi of, I forget the name. So
Dronacharya.
Yeah, Dronacharya. And he was his son, a great warrior. And as long as he was alive, no one could perhaps touch Dronacharya. So when Dronacharya was literally slaying the Pandavas, then Yudhishthira, who's reputed to never have told a lie in his life, was advised and guided, I think, by none other than Lord Krishna himself, to say Ashwatthama is dead. And after that, in a slightly low tone, the elephant. And Ashwatthama is dead was said by, when he said the elephant, there was a whole roar of, you know, trumpets and so on. So that voice was kind of muted and Dronacharya only heard that Ashwatthama is dead. Now, he believed that, you know, Yudhishthira will never tell a lie. B, Yudhishthira may have had a guilty conscience, but he said, you know, I spoke the truth. It's a different thing that he didn't hear. But I think the more important thing is that Dronacharya, even if Ashwatthama, his son, was dead, other soldiers who were dying were also sons of, you know, fathers and mothers. Why would he put down his arms? By hearing the news, even if, let us say, for a moment you imagine that Ashwatthama was actually dead, should not Dronacharya have gone with greater vigor to fight? Having said that, again, what is ethical, unethical? Sometimes we understand these are amoral. I'm not talking about immoral, moral and amoral. Because what is ultimately the overall objective? Sometimes the leader has to stretch and stray into areas which traditionally may not, you know, fit into the ethical mold. So here, the overall idea was to win the war. The same thing happened in Lord Rama's. You had to conquer Lanka to retrieve Sita Mata. And there between the fight in Bali and Sugriva, there's another story. So sometimes when the overall objective is very clear and the other side is kind of not following the ethical rules to the hilt, then I think it is not in that particular limited set of circumstances to transgress slightly with view of the overall objective in mind. That is how I would be able to explain it.
Probably from that, the quote came, everything is fair in love and war. This is, whatever happens, happens for the best, is one of the key mantra in Bhagavad Gita. Then how can we justify adversity in our life on the basis of this dictum?
You know, whatever happens, happens for the best is that something which has happened, it has happened. No, it cannot unhappen. So you cannot go in past and rectify it. You can only go back to the drawing board and start. And sometimes, you know, everyone would have found, and as youngsters will grow, you will find that if this one particular thing had not happened, which at that time looked to me as a huge adversity, perhaps I would not have been able to reach this point. For instance, had Lord Rama not been exiled under whatever circumstances by his father, you know, so many Rakshasas and so on who got moksha and a tyrant king of Lanka, that would have not been, you know, vanquished. Similarly, in Mahabharata, some small inane remark by Draupadi to Duryodhan, ke blind ka, you know, son of a blind is a blind, andhe ka beta andhai hoga, when he fell into that water body in Indraprastha. So those things which happen ultimately lead to some consequences. For instance, Steve Jobs, if people interested in modern management, of course, Steve Jobs was greatly affected by the teaching of the Indian spiritual gurus. And he said, you know, had I not quit college, you know, I would have still been, you know, working as a paid employee. Had I not learned calligraphy classes, the new fonts which went into my original Apple computer wouldn't have been there. Had I not been kicked out of my first job, I would have not had my own startup. And had that not been acquired, I would have not been the CEO. So there is a set of circumstances, which adversities which come, which at that time actually look like a big setback, but they then perhaps, you know, transform you, divert you into a direction where you receive your higher calling. And that's why spiritual gurus often say, not getting what you want is sometimes the best thing that can happen to you. And that is what connecting the dots is all about. When those things happen, you say nothing could be worse could have happened. And 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And when you connect the dots backwards, do you realize that there was a grand scheme of things? And even if the Lord Almighty had given you the script, you know, the pen to write your own script, you wouldn't have been able to do it beautifully. And all those people who have scaled heights in their career would attribute to no small matter to very happy accidents that happened. And at that time, they were seen as setbacks. So it is in this sense that whatever happens, happens for the best, I would like to say.
So before we wind up, like you have been a successful during your academics and your successful career, how would you motivate the persons how to do well, how to, as they say, you have to plan something in your life? What do you say for a young aspirant, or for that matter, anyone, how he should visualize and actually what he contemplates, he translates into real life? Because they say, I was just in FM, one of the famous it's more like this thing, they often quietly say that success has no fixed formula. Otherwise, everybody would have followed. Everyone has to follow his own success mantra, though parameters could be the same.
You know, first of all, every youngster needs to know where he wants to get to. What is uska lakshya kya hai? He should be very clear about that. That I want to be a great lawyer. I want to have a practice and have a law firm and open branches, or I want to be elevated to the high court. Is that what I want to do? Do I want to do LLB and get into the judicial services? Do you want to take the civil service examination? Of course, as you said, plan B can always be there, but one broad lakshya. There are people who say, no, I want to have my own startup. I'm a techie, and this is something which I can. In your day and age, perhaps you didn't have the liberty of venture capital funding and so on, but I have. So A, where you want to get, you have to be very clear. And you really have to have hunger, passion to be able to succeed in that direction. If you say, okay, there is a goal and a mission statement, and each morning you have a look at it, but you are not infused by it. B, you are not working towards it. There is no palpable action, much less an action plan. But what I say, ultimately, hard work is important. You have to strive for excellence. Mediocrity may earn you a living, but it will not get you to the higher goals. So you have to really, I'm not using the word perfection. In fact, perfection is the prerogative of gods, and we mortals can only aim at perfection and only at excellence. And so whatever you want to do, do it with passion, do it with a sense of direction and focus, and no mediocrity. You have to work, you know, towards perfection and in search of excellence, and you will definitely get there. And sometimes, you know, many IAS aspirants, they say, okay, sir, we've taken so many attempts. We've tried and went to the interview in one attempt, and then ultimately we couldn't make it. As they say, you know, the pilgrimage is in the journey and sometimes not in the ultimate darshan. So even in trying for this, you may not, as we said, ultimate objective and reaching palki icha, you may not get what you wanted, but that journey, the effort would have changed you. If you have studied hard for a legal profession, if you have studied hard for the civil service examination, you would pick up numerous skills, which even if you were not a lawyer or a civil servant, they would stand you in good stead. So hard work with focus in pursuit of excellence is never wasted. And that is the ultimate capital that you carry with you. But while you do that, also see what you can do for others. You can start early, you can start small. And that is what ultimately are those karmic points that you carry, and also gives you a tremendous internal satisfaction that, okay, you know, fine, I'm a single person lawyer shop. This is my first thing, but I would also like to do this for the people who are not as lucky as me.
I'm reminded what you said of the hard work. Often during the young time, it was said, and my father used to often say that greatness of great men was not achieved in sudden flight. It was achieved while others were sleeping at night. So it has been a wonderful session. Before we part for today, could you just give the gist of your talk in 2 minutes so that people could just, because we are so used to just like Maggi noodles, there are noodles, there are chow meins. But one cherishes that immediately. What could be the ultimate capsule, what you have talked? And before, sir, we would also ask you to, since we, at least I have been reading your articles on Medium and following you on the Facebook, etc. If you could just share some of your articles so that we can post on the WhatsApp group of Beyond Law, so that the lessons, what they've learned today, but different flips you have given on leadership, communication skills, that would give them the good hindsight of the issues which would be relevant for them. Yes, sir. What would be your take for the 2 minutes?
I'll be sending you the Medium articles, and of course, you are at liberty. They're already in the public domain to circulate in whatever medium you feel like. No, I'm glad that this question was asked. And, you know, I was reading somewhere that when you make a speech, what is a great way to make a speech? He said, you first tell them what you want to tell them. Unko kya batana hai, tell them. And then you tell the story. And then you tell them what you told them. In other words, to ultimately summarize, in our governmental meetings especially, you know, we deliberate for 2 hours. And then sometimes we leave. Okay, and it's my takya kalam. I say, tat kya nikala? You know, what is the gist of this meeting? You know, what's the actionable? So my take, again, everyone is entitled to their own inferences and their own deductions and own distilled wisdom. It's first, when in doubt, follow your own internal inner GPS. A lot of time you'll find youngsters saying, you know, I wanted to do this, but my mom simply said like this thing. So you have to follow your inner GPS, irrespective of the external noise. There's going to be a lot of noise, and there's going to be a lot of stress also within the family otherwise. But when ethical and such questions come, follow your inner GPS and follow your inner passion. And the other is, do good, do your best, you know, without expecting anything in return, not in terms of phal ki ichha. You do an act of strangeness, kindness to a stranger, it will come back to you in, you know, different ways. I mean, many of people would say, you know, from perfect strangers have received such help, which, you know, my friends for decades were not able to do whenever they were in a position to do. So also do that. Somewhere the universe is also throwing back what you did for someone to a person who potentially was never going to be in a position to help you. So do that. And other is, if you have to, ultimately action has to be there. You don't have the luxury of thinking things through forever. And action has to be discerning action. Contemplate, decide, no paralysis by overanalysis. But once you are clear, then 100% put into that action and take it to the logical conclusion. And as you do so, as you rise up in the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, do try and look inwards and say, what is my ultimate calling? What is my purpose of being in this planet? What is my legacy? And legacy is not the estate that you leave in the hands of your heirs. It is the thoughts. What type of remembrances the people will have after you're no longer there? Or even otherwise, you shift from the scene of action in the thoughts and minds of the people. So that is what this whole pursuit of leadership, this life is all about. And I think as we trudge along, this is the 2-minute lesson that I could say. And thank you very much.
What you have summed up, I could just feel that what we always said, that there are 3 hours for whatever you do. That is revise, revisit, and review. And then what you said, I'm also reminded, it said that though the heart is on the left, but it always thinks right. And when we were thinking of calling you on the platform, the heart always said that you have to call him. And today we feel that the decision is perfect. And that's what the entire call. Those who have been connecting with us on the platform, tomorrow the webinar would be on a very interesting topic relevant with the current scenario. We have Constitution Anti-Defection Law in India. That is by Mr. Satpal Jain, senior advocate from Punjab Haryana High Court. He's a former member parliament from Chandigarh itself. He's an presently additional solicitor general also, and he had been in the law commission. Thank you, sir, for giving the insightful session. It looked, when we had discussed the topic, that how could one connect leadership with the scriptures? But as they say, successful people don't do different things, but they do it differently. The topic of leadership you have connected in such a manner, I think it will be remembered for all times to come, because leadership, if we go on the YouTube or on the books, we invariably find 7 effective steps, leadership, what has to be done. But how to connect it with the scriptures is an art, not only for this leadership part, but it is also as to how, if we have to read the scriptures, how we have to connect and how we can be imbibed in the life to learn things forward. So everyone stay safe, stay blessed. And thank you on behalf of Beyond Law CLC, those who have been watching us on the Facebook, as well as on this platform. And above all, as they say, like there is any star cast, that even if somebody comes as a guest appearance, like a touring personality of Amitabh Bachchan, they always write above all. But here is a person who, he came, he saw him, he conquered the entire platform. Thank you on behalf of Beyond Law CLC for giving us a session, which will be remembered for all times to come. Everyone stay safe, stay blessed. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.